our Lord, you are almighty and have power over the universe. To the crowd pressing upon you, you said, power has gone out from me. Then to the hemorrhaging woman who was healed by touching the fringe of your clothes, you said, daughter, your faith has made you whole, go in peace. Now we ask you to heal us from every sin, that we may stand with purity before you all the days of our lives. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Thank you.
Physician, Mother of all people, we thank you for your compassion, for you have bandaged the wounds of our suffering humanity. Heal the sick and comfort the sorrowful. Accept our prayers as you accepted the plea of the hemorrhaging woman. Bless our community that prays to you. We believe that you are our Savior and Redeemer, and we await the day of your glorious resurrection. To you be glory and thanks forever.
For behold, what earnestness this godly sorrow has produced for you, as well as readiness for a defense, and indignation and fear and yearning, and zeal and punishment. In every way you have shown yourselves to be innocent in the matter. Praise be to God always.
Her parents were astounded.
and he instructed them to tell no one what had happened. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, for giving us his words of life. Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
Someone has touched me, for I know that power has gone out from me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Of course, in this gospel, it's initiated by the question of healing and remedy. Illness. Illness, of course, that's a deficiency and a weakness within a system. And so what's initiated as a question of healing ultimately becomes a question of a resuscitation, a return to life from the dead. And we're beginning the series of three resuscitations that take place by our Lord. The daughter of Jairus, who has just died, probably just in the period of hours. The next resuscitation that our Lord will accomplish is the widow's son of Nain. And this young man has been dead for over a day and a half, probably 2 days, when the cortege has met, leaving the city to bury the body. And our Lord brings him also back to life. And the third, which is why this connects with Lazarus' Saturday, what we're going to try to do over these next weeks is speak about the ceremonies of Passion Week, to speak about the ceremonies of that week just before we celebrate the glorious resurrection. But of course, the Saturday before is known as Lazarus' Saturday. And that weekend, Lazarus Saturday, Shanini, Hosanna Sunday, or Palm Sunday, was a weekend always, and still to this day is dedicated, in a sense, for children. As the children who cried out to welcome our Lord on Palm Sunday, so it's always been in the Syriac tradition, which influences Egypt and in Ethiopia. Palm Sunday is actually the biggest day of the year. It outstrips Christmas, it outstrips Easter. A couple years ago when I was at the cathedral, on Shanini, of course, the cathedral was jammed full of people. Lots of little children in all of their Sunday best. Candles decorated, glorious day. Of course, the following week on the glorious resurrection, there was about a quarter of them there. So that was a downside. But it's the reason why in Egypt last year, the bombs went off and exploded on Palm Sunday, because the Muslims knew that this was the biggest day of the year. But they are a series of returns of life, of resuscitation. This daughter of Jairus being the first. Lazarus had been dead for 4 days in the tomb, buried, building up, and that is the definitive resuscitation, of giving life, resurrection, which kind of puts the last nail in the coffin of our Lord, so to speak, and the persecution by the authorities, by the priests, and by the Jews at the temple. So today we have what's initiated as a question and a quest for healing, but winds up turning as a return from the dead to life of this 12-year-old girl. St. Bede, in his commentary on this gospel, he says that the spiritual application of the meaning of this 12-year-old girl is of the soul which is still young in the ways of God, who's only beginning the spiritual life. Doesn't matter what their chronological age is, but spiritually they are still small, they are still weak, and so the thoughts, the inundations, the attachments, the distractions of this world can easily kill it by serious sin. So St. Bede gives a whole interpretation then around this. What we want to consider is the number 12 that's here. 12, the hemorrhaging of this poor woman. This woman who has been bleeding, who has continued had this flow of blood for well over a decade. And we're told by St. Luke that not only has she had this, but that she's also spent all of her money on doctors trying to be healed, and no one's been able to heal her, and now she's also destitute and in poverty. But of course, her blood flow begins by coincidence at the same time when this little girl is born, because we're told that the girl is about 12. This is part of the context of the gospel. The very next chapter, chapter 9, which begins as soon as this ending of this story that's told here about the hemorrhaging woman, begins by our Lord taking his disciples and naming 12, the apostles, and sending them out also to preach, to cast out demons, and to heal the sick. So the 12 are also established immediately after this episode. Which brings us to the first part of the context of our gospel. Our gospel begins today, a little unusually, by saying, and everyone welcomed our Lord with great enthusiasm because they were waiting for him. Which is kind of an abrupt way to begin the gospel. So why this enthusiasm of receiving our Lord? Well, because on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, in the earlier part of this chapter 8 of St. Luke, our Lord is in Gennesaret. And Gennesaret is a city on the left side, on the eastern side of the sea. But it's where our Lord, when he disembarks, he has this man who's completely enraged and out of his mind and possessed coming at our Lord. He lives in the cemetery along the shore. He has been driven out of the community by the people by his actions. But he also is also known not only to be sick mentally, but he's also possessed. He exerts an extraordinary form of strength. They can't hold him down, they can't restrain him, so they drive him out of the community. And it's an unusual story because it's quite dramatic. Our Lord has the demons cast out of this man, and they go into this herd of pigs. And the swine go running off the side of the cliff, being driven mad by the presence of the demonic, and they drown in the sea. Well, everyone hears about this story. And the man himself is freed, made whole. And he's the man who is told, go home now. Return to where you came from, and tell everyone what has been done for you. As opposed to the times when he tells everyone, don't tell everyone. And in this gospel, he tells the parents, tell no one about this. So that's the context of this episode that takes place here. And of course, it has both the aspect of death in it, of course, this gospel today, but also sickness. And we see in the prayers of the Mass this morning, this continual emphasis upon the healing that our Lord brings, that he bandages, that he pours ointment on, that he is here to console and to bring a healing and an integrity, a wholeness to us, both as mankind and also individually. And as we go through Lent, we're looking at what is it that leads me to death? What are my attachments? What are my sins? What are my thoughts, my words, my actions? My omissions, the things that I should be doing that I've not been doing. This is why the woman is chosen, because she has a chronic illness. This has gone on for years. And in the spiritual order, of course, we call that our predominant fault. The sin that I keep kind of like a little pet. It's the one that I go back to so easily. I don't maybe like it, but it's just part of what I am. It's the man who's always angry and who just tells everyone, well, that's just the way I am. Well, Lent is meant to be the moment of examining where are those wounds in my life? What causes me to hemorrhage? And so the predominant fault is central in the spiritual life as we examine during these weeks of Lent, because it's the thing that I go back to so easily and the thing that I am personally inclined to. Maybe anger, it may be thoughts of rash judgment, it may be gossip, it may be a number of different things. And each of us during the time of Lent are receiving special graces and light so that we may see ourselves more clearly and able to go forward. So this poor woman, who is in the crowd. By hemorrhaging, by the Mosaic law, she is considered unclean. Liturgically, ceremonially, socially, she's unclean. And she is not meant to be in contact with anyone around her. It is part of the reason why this woman does not go and appear before our Lord and ask for healing. She's not supposed to be here. She's unclean. So this poor woman has not only gone through this whole illness for 12 years and had spent all of her money trying to be healed. This woman is also socially an outcast by the law of Moses. And she's for 12 years suffered this horrible public humiliation, which is why in her mind what she's saying is she hears about this rabbi. And her idea is, if I can come close enough just to touch, not him, not to address him, but to be in this crowd, which is why she comes at this moment. She doesn't stand out. She's just part of the bustle of this enthusiastic crowd that surrounds our Lord. And she says to herself, we're told in another gospel, if only I can touch the fringe of the hem of his garment. So what is she talking about? Now in Maine, it's a little less difficult. In the parish a couple years ago when I was working in New York, it was easier because we always saw the Hasidic Jews all around. And you'll see them have these tassels that come out under their shirts, little strings that hang out when you go to New York. And those are the fringes as in the 21st century. The law of Moses required that the men wear fringes on the bottom of their garments. Well, when everybody wore cassocks and everybody was dressed more or less like this, it went on the bottom of your cloak. So it was the very edge of your cloak, and it was to remind you of God's commandments and the directive and the law of God that surrounded you as a daily memorial. So what this woman says is that I will not confront the rabbi, I'm unclean. I will not try to approach him, and I certainly won't touch him physically, because I'm unclean. It will make him unclean. A woman who was unclean or a man who was unclean, whatever they touched also became unclean. Your pots, your pans, your dishes, everything else became unclean for certain periods of time. So she won't touch the rabbi. But the idea in humility is that what I will do is I will touch not even his own clothing, but the fringe and the strings that hang off the bottom of his clothing. That's what this woman has been reduced to over 12 years. And that's why she's in the crowd and she's on her knees, and surely other people are on their knees also welcoming the rabbi. She doesn't stand up. And in the midst of the crowd, she's pushing through all this jostle of people just to be able to touch the bottom of it, just so I have some contact. And this reminds us of what we spoke on last week and considered is this touch of the Messiah. This contact that we have with our Lord, without which salvation is impossible. It's why we are baptized. It's why we enter into the transformed humanity of Jesus Christ. That contact that we have in the divine mysteries, which is why last week we considered why week after week this transformation that takes place of us, because we have this contact with our Lord in the sacred mysteries. So what this woman is doing is the same. When our Lord arrives at Jairus' house, he takes the girl by the hand. He touches her. He touches the leper. He heals us in this way. And it's clear that when we make progress in the spiritual life, in that proximity of life, week after week, we enter into that mystery of light, which means that we see more clearly. And in seeing, it's not always very pleasant. But it's the beginning of our healing. If we don't know what our predominant fault is, we do nothing to heal it. We do nothing to remedy it. So we first need the diagnosis that we have leukemia. We need the diagnosis of where I am wounded. And so this woman doesn't need any outward. She knows what she has been suffering of 12 years. She is, from that point, representative of the enlightened soul moving towards our Lord more profoundly.
And in that story then, when she's reaching through the crowd just to touch the bottom of this little piece of cloth, our Lord, we're told by St. Luke, she's immediately healed. She knows this. So you can imagine at the same moment the rabbi stops, someone has touched me. And everyone in the crowd that's been jostling all around him as he's pushing through the crowd with his disciples, they all start saying, it wasn't me, not me, not me. Very human. So we always do. No, I didn't do it. Not me, not me. And our Lord says again, but I know someone has touched me because power has gone out from me. And Peter gives, as usually Peter does, the very practical answer by saying, Lord, we're in the middle of a crowd. There's people all over the place. Why are you asking the question? Someone's touched me. They're bumping into us the whole time. And that's when he says, the power has left me. And that's when we are told by St. Luke, this woman realizes she's been caught up. And no one's pointing at her, but she knows within herself that she is the one that our Lord is speaking of. And that's why St. Luke tells us she comes up and she is terrified. She's trembling and she throws herself down at his feet because she is unclean. She has violated the law of Moses. She's not supposed to be here. And she tried to touch a rabbi, making him unclean. It's arrogant. It's self-centered. It is considered to be selfish because she's also going to contaminate all the people in the crowd. That is the vision of the law of Moses. So she is in terror. So when she comes, she's trembling, she falls in front of our Lord, and she begins, certainly in the midst of sobs, begins to tell what had happened, how long she had suffered, and why I tried to do this thing today, but I have been healed. What our Lord is doing is twofold. One, he is making the woman confront the reality of what she is. And that's painful. That's part of the progress of the spiritual life that we do not like. Who wants to hear that we have leukemia? Who wants to hear that we have something that is going to kill us? And yet, if we don't look at our spiritual lives, where we are vis-a-vis the gospel, then we are certainly going to die. So our Lord is doing one thing. He is bringing her into the light of wisdom. But what he is doing, even more importantly, is he's doing this to her so that she can be rehabilitated and brought back into the community. Everyone knows that she's been unclean. But he makes this a public event so that he can say to her, it is your faith that has made you whole, my daughter. Go in peace. And he rehabilitates her and reincorporates her into the community by rehabilitation. This is the reconciliation of the mystery of penance. This is the sacrament that heals us and brings us back into that communion of saints, that restoration of the life which is the body of the church. And she goes in peace. And of course, as that dramatic aspect of the raising of the daughter of Jairus, we have the same thing. She's not dying. She's only sleeping. Nothing is permanent. Not sin, not our predominant faults, not the evils in our lives, not the circumstances that surround us, and not even death is permanent if you believe. It comes up in two instances here in this gospel. You must have loyalty. You must have confidence, but if you do, not even death will be an obstacle to you. And that is the raising of the daughter of Jairus. He is touched by the hand of this little girl. Only her parents are there, and the three who are going to be central to the rest of the gospel, Peter, James, and John. And he says, Talitha Kumi, St. Mark tells us in Aramaic. Little girl, arise. And we're told immediately she comes to and stands up. It is a very domestic scene. Only the parents are there, these other few men. And then he says, give her something to eat. It's very touching in the whole aspect, but in both of these things are reminding us that what we are seeking is healing. What we are looking for is wisdom. Lord, let me see what I am as you see me. That reality is going to happen at the moment of our death and judgment anyways. We might as well ask for it now while we can remedy it than waiting for the shock and horror of the moment of our death. So we ask in wisdom to see where we are, what is each of us, what is my predominant fault, so that we have purpose and we have a goal and we know what virtues we have to practice. So that in doing so, our hope is established even more groundedly and our faith is elevated even higher within this wisdom. And the purpose given to us is that progress within Lent and beyond Lent for our whole life as we walk on this path of the gospel, seeking that transformation by the touch of Christ in our lives individually. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
We believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only God, Son of God, Father and Father before all ages, God from God, light from light.
blessings upon them and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, and Saint Mary, and Saint Jude, and Saint Charbonne. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the attentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility.
It is right and just.
Truly it is right and just to glorify and exalt you, O Maker of all creation. With the angels we glorify you. And with voices of praise we cry out and we proclaim. Have compassion and mercy upon us. saying,
"Have mercy on us, Almighty Father, have mercy on us."
O Lord, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we profess our faith in you, and we ask you, have compassion on us, O God, have mercy on us and hear us.
How awesome is this moment, my beloved, for the living Holy Spirit descend and rest upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we
I
you strengthen and encourage us, for we are weak. We implore you to purify us from every sin and to accept our offering, so that in one spirit we may call upon you, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
Lord, lead us not into the trials of temptation that we do not have the strength to overcome. But deliver us from every evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your Holy Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, gives life to those who partake of it. And receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your worshippers who bow before you and implore you. Make them worthy of your mercy and forgive their sins, for you are almighty and rich in compassion. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen. Amen.
Each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask Him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is one in heaven and on earth, to give Him glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your Lord, have
Accompany you, Father, and the Son,